I had to move the cat out of the way to sit down here. Sometimes we need to move our perspectives out of the way. And the spiritual path is all about shifting perspective. So you may have a different perspective today than you had yesterday, and that's a good thing. We need to have a fluidity, an openness of mind, and be able to shift perspectives in a certain way. Yesterday, June 1st, was a day of enormous breakthroughs. And what was said then was, what is really taking place, a way to look at it, is that we're prepping for time, we're preparing to step into time. But the key fact is, we have not yet stepped into time. In fact, nothing has ever stepped into time yet. It's never happened. And it never will happen. Therefore, why are we doing all this prepping? One of the ways that we're prepping is that we're prepping for an otherness, In other words, time is a condition supposedly in which reality is not yet real. So it's not yet what it is. So it's, as it were, fragmented in parts. It's being assembled, as it were. The idea is that somehow it's being assembled. So to prep to step into time, we're prepping with this notion of otherness, with bodies, with people, with all these separate identities. But all this stuff is not yet happened at all. We're literally preparing. We're getting into a role, as it were. We're trying to get into the role of otherness, of separateness, of bodies, so that when we step into time, it will seem normal to us. And the fact that I've seen is that there is no stepping into time. There never will be. So all this prepping is entirely unnecessary. Now, also, we're prepping for complexity. So there's all this effort. When I talk about fourth dimension, 4D, it simply is a more intense prepping. It's a situation of more intense preparation to step into time. It's more intense than, it's more complex than 3D. 3D is also a prepping to step into time. But 4D increases the complexity, you know, quantumly. So you have all these 4D preppers here in the world right now who are showing us this is how you prep. We know how to really prep for time. And they're very adept at super complexity. They have all these computers and software programs, and they're able to work with molecules and all these pharmaceuticals and gene sequencing, all this complexity. You know, they're saying, this, look at our prepping, it's super prepping. And everybody goes, wow, you're really advanced in your preparation, huh? And then along comes Jones, as it were, and says, hey, folks, all this prepping is entirely unnecessary. All this prepping is entirely necessary. Mary says, what are you talking about? No, we have advanced prep. We have advanced prep to step into time. And so I say, there is no complexity to reality. Reality is not complex. It's perfect. All right. So this seems like a more profound way to deal with, to look at the 3D and 4D, etc. as different styles of preparation, different levels of complexity, sophistication. Now, 4D is simply those who have been preparing to step into time for a long time. And they've worked really hard at it. They've really tried to figure out, how do we prep to step into time? And they've just been at it a longer time, which, if you really want to be honest with the situation, it means that they've been really dumb for a longer time, which is nothing to crow about. In other words, they've been engaged in something completely unnecessary efforts that will never be utilized in any way, shape, or form. They've been engaged in that for a very, very long time and putting all their time, all their efforts into it, which is, you know, nothing to brag about, that is for sure. Nothing to brag about. And hey, they don't realize that. They feel proud of it. Proud of this. We're superior. We've been working on this for a much longer time. We've made so much more progress in prep to step into time. And I just have to say, folks, there is no such thing as time. We'll never step into time. There'll never be any stepping into time. That's all a hypothetical scenario. So what is required of everybody who's been prepping for time is to repent. In other words, to realize this will never be used. All this prepping that's been taking place will never be used. It's all completely unnecessary. And that's the repentance that needs to take place. So don't be proud about the preparation you've done to step into time. It'll never be used. It's nothing to be proud about. And it's the disillusionment is the recognition that it'll never be used. And that is very sobering, not easy. So that is recognized. There's compassion in the recognition that it is quite humbling to realize that all these efforts that we've done are utterly useless. Never be utilized. So the spiritual path is difficult in that we have to come to terms with the fact that this prep has been completely useless. Then how do we, you know, accept that? It's not easy. But certainly we cannot have the inmates in charge of the asylum. So we cannot have a situation where spiritual pride in prepping is in charge, as large and in charge, because then there'll be no repentance. And that's what's happening to the world right now, is it's out of balance. There's too much fourth dimensionality here of spiritual pride, of the prep work that's been done coming into this world, prep as people, as bodies, which is part of the prep work, and saying, look, we really have developed this to an extraordinary extent, and we're going to teach you how to do that too. And of course, wisdom will say, oh, no, 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 no. We have no interest in that. We have no interest in preparing to step into time, because time doesn't exist. It never will. There's no such thing as time. There never will be. In other words, there's no such thing as the incompleteness of reality. There's no precursor to reality. It's something that came before that was incomplete. There's no incompleteness to reality. There is nothing and everything residing in nothing and everything always. There is no otherness. There is no otherness. There is no fragmentation. So we have a situation in the world now where, again, spiritual pride is in charge. And that's a bad thing. You will find that the prepping for time also involves tremendous destructivity, and as a way to simulate the stepping into time. So everything I've said still stands, except there's a new perspective that kind of gives it a much fresher look and clearer look, is that we haven't yet stepped into time. It's never happened. So everything is still perfect. Everything is still perfect. It's all perfect. But this world existence is what we have imagined as a training tool to prepare to step into time. Because stepping into time, of course, would mean annihilation of reality, actually. So we're prepping for the annihilation of reality and trying to figure out how can we be in time. Well, we can be a separate self, a vulnerable body, an intelligence, a cleverness, and all this kind of stuff. So all this destructivity and death, etc., that we have imagined as a training tool for spirit to learn how to die, all that is really preparing for this to happen, but it hasn't yet happened. This is the key point. It hasn't happened at all. Nothing has happened yet. Nothing has happened yet. And the truth is that nothing will ever happen. Nothing will ever happen to identity at all. We'll never step into time. Spirit will never step into time. So ordinarily the cat gets off the couch here. But this time the cat's staying on. Which shows that we don't have to get rid of the body. We don't have to get rid of all this prep. We just have to accept that it's will never be utilized, and so we don't need to identify with it. Part of the prep is to identify with incompleteness, with this hypothetical incompleteness. You see, all of this existence is hypothetical. We're saying that hypothetically, we're simulating a stepping into time. Okay, it's all a simulation. It's all a simulation. It's like a flight simulator, except you'll never actually get in a plane and fly it. We're just in a simulator, simulating time. It's not time, this is a simulation of time. So this is the key point. This is all a simulation in our imagination. Mind is presenting a simulation to spirit of what it would be like if spirit could step into time. But the key realization is we will never step into time. There's no such thing as time. It's impossible to step into time. There's no such thing to step into. We never will. So this simulation is simply completely unnecessary. Now we don't have to take the simulation seriously. It can still be here. The cat can still be on the couch, but it's moved over. And we don't have to take all this simulation seriously. We don't have to take it seriously that we're a body, that we're a person, that we're a separate entity, that we dwell in impermanence and all this stuff. We don't have to take it seriously. We can see that it's just a simulation. And we can abide, the self can abide within the self. So we are pushing the breakthroughs now. In June is, we made it through May, and May was the real tough month where the fourth dimensionals put the hammer down, and this is now the response to that is the breakthroughs that just they failed. They didn't succeed. They didn't succeed, which is a good thing. It's too late for them. It's too late. Now, at this point, it's too late. The cat is out of the bag now. And this truth is being presented here in this world. And so their attempt to subjugate the world, as it were, didn't work, because this clarity is now being shared in the world, presented. So I say it's too late. It's too late for them now. They weren't able to shut it down entirely. They weren't able to impose their pride upon the world entirely, and therefore the door is open for us. The door is open for us. They didn't succeed, at least to shut this clarity down. They didn't succeed in it. So that's why now it's pouring out, and it's very profound. And the truth is, here's the question, how do you succeed in preparing to step into time? It's a very valuable question to consider. How do we succeed in our prep? How does one succeed in preparing to step into time when there's no such thing as time and it'll never be stepped into? How can success be defined? What kind of definition of success can we come up with? And if you consider it, it's realized the idea of succeeding. A successful preparation is absurd. How can we successfully prepare to step into what is not, will never be there, and will never step into it? How can we succeed in that? How can we say we've succeeded? We can only say that it was just an aimless wandering around. That's all we can say about it. It wasn't any real preparation at all. not really. So how can we take pride in that? Not really. No, we need to repent. Instead of pride, we need repentance. Repentance is just to say, we were just aimlessly wandering around in a dream of folly and confusion. And there was really no preparation at all taking place. It was just imaginary, simulated what-ifs that we just made up. We just made it all up. We just assumed that this is what it would be like if we stepped into time. But these assumptions really have no basis at all, because there isn't any such thing as time. So how can we know what it would be like? We cannot know, because there's never going to be such a thing, a situation. There's never going to be an incompleteness. There's never going to be a lack of totality. So it's ridiculous to even speculate about it. But we've just been speculating about it. Like, what if? I wonder what if such a thing as spirit could die to itself. I wonder, what would that be like? But there isn't any way to know what can ever be. There's no way to know it. No way whatsoever. So the fourth dimensional preppers definitely tried to shut me down. They wanted to shut repentance down on this planet. The war taking place on this planet is a war against repentance, actually. Jesus said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand," or said something like that. Right. In other words, the totality, the completeness, nothing and everything, residing in nothing and everything, is already the case. It's never been lost. Time has never started. So perfection is still perfection. We are still experiencing, the totality is still experiencing the totality, as always. It's right here. And so repent means give up your spiritual pride of preparation, preparing to leave totality. Give up your pride in preparing to leave totality. So the fourth dimensionals has come to this planet, and they've been waging a war against repentance. In other words, they're trying to establish pride in place of repentance. Not many third dimensionals have understood repentance at all, actually. It's just a different style of preparing. The third dimensional preparation is a different style of preparing. The pride is still there, but there's been some, at least the idea of repentance is been circulating in this world, because we've been notified of its necessity by Jesus and by others who say, you need to repent. The kingdom of heaven is already at hand. You already have it. You're already dwelling in it. But you're preparing to dwell in some other scenario outside of it, outside of nothing and everything, as it were. And we were told that this is just spiritual pride. And so we need to repent, meaning drop the prep. Stop preparing for what will never happen. But the fourth dimensionals don't seem to have a sense of repentance at all. I don't get any feeling from the fourth dimensionals that there's any awareness of the need to repent at all. What I feel is they're so caught up in the pride of complexity of their own complex preparations, whatever that means, it doesn't really mean anything. But once you lose a reference point and you're within illusions, then illusions become your reference point, then complexity seems to have some sort of meaning. But it's only a meaning relative to other illusions. Once you stop realizing the non-necessity of this preparation, then you can, pride builds up this notion of pride. It's as if there's this insolvable problem, and we're tackling it more and more, trying to tackle it and break it down and rearrange in all these pieces. We have this impossible problem. We break it into all these pieces. We rearrange all these pieces, etc., thinking that in doing so somehow we'll understand, you know, it will be possible. But no, it's just we're just time idly spent, really, is all you can say about it. So there's a lack of repentance in fourth dimensionality, an unawareness of it. And so that attitude has been brought into the world now. August 18th, 1999, is when this attitude of non-repentance was able to push the attitude of repentance in this world, push it aside, because the attitude of repentance in this world had been undermined in the, let's say, the first in the 20th century. It had been undermined, severely undermined. And at that time, August 18th, 1999, I believe, yeah, this attitude of non-repentance was able to push the attitude of repentance on 3D aside, and so it could then, this attitude of spiritual pride could flood into this planet. Could flood into this planet unrestrained. And from that point on, there's just been this rapid spread of this spiritual pride, which you can easily see on the internet and people's comments, etc., of now this just utter disdain for anything that could be remotely associated with repentance, whether you call religion or spirituality, or whatever you want to call it. There's this extreme disdain for it now. Which is why this planet is not a hospitable place for the attitudes of repentance at this time. Not that 3D was very hospitable either. But there was at least a sense that something fundamental, we're doing something fundamentally wrong. They were called original sin. In other words, the idea of prepping for time is the original sin. That it's an inherent impossibility. We're trying to accomplish the impossible. Ultimately, spirit is trying to die to itself, and time is just the idea of this death. Stepping into time would be like a spiritual death, spirit dying unto itself. So the idea of the desire to be prime creator is the original sin. And the attempt to prepping for time is what needs to be repented. But so there's this feeling of something is fundamentally, we're doing something fundamentally wrong. And we need to don't take pride in what we're doing. That is what has been seeded on this planet in 3D by those who are aware of this. So there's some of that in 3D. But it wasn't robust enough to push back 4D, the pride of 4D. It wasn't robust enough. There was an undermining in the 20th century through entertainment, drugs, media, licentiousness, depravity, war, all these kinds of things, all this mixture that undermined and said, hey, you know, prepping can be fun. That's what 40's saying. Hey, prepping can be really fun. Look at all these new designer drugs that we can distribute, and all these steroids and hormones, and, you know, free love, you know, unrestrained sexual activity in any way. It's no more consequence. We can cure all diseases. You know, no pregnancies, nothing. Let's, you know, just all these new forms of music. Let's look how fun prepping can be. And people start saying, wow, maybe repentance is just for old fogies, you know, who don't know what they're talking about. Let's go out and sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, this is great, you know. And so that's undermining. That was the undermining of fourth dimensional pride, was undermining the attitude of repentance on this planet. And it was a severe invasion, actually. So this was the bombardment, the mortar and the artillery bombardment of this planet. The television, the radio, the worldwide dissemination of this attitude of non-repentance through the entertainment and media and news. and networks, and coming into every living room, every bedroom, everything. And then all the pill came along, so people, their whole attitudes turned towards, look how much fun we can have. Why should we be worrying about repentance? You know, so that the artillery and the mortar shells all softened up this planet. And then the high tech came in and got their foot in the door. And then and eventually this attitude of non-repentance and spiritual pride was able to get unrestrained access to this planet and push their agenda upon this planet without and steamroll the opposition, steamroll it. And the steamrolling has been continuing on. And what happened was in May of 2013 was basically the consolidation and crystallization of that control by fourth dimension upon this planet, imposing their will upon 3D entirely, where even the pretense was dropped. Obviously, the pretense was dropped during May of 2013, which is what I had foreseen and talked about prior to that. And so all these scandals, the third dimensional people are saying, whoa, wait a minute, you know, look at what you're doing, this is terrible. And fourth dimension just says, oh, nothing here, nothing to see here, must move on, and just brush it aside, like, because they know that they're in charge, that their attitude is in charge. See, it's an attitude thing, it's an attitude of spiritual pride. They know that they're in charge now, and so they don't even have to worry about trying to give a pretense of fair play, of, you know, 50-50 right down the line, let's just split it. And no, they are imposing their will, and they don't have to pretend like that they're being fair about it anymore. That's where we're at now. However, concurrently with that, the fifth dimensional awareness is now blossoming here. They couldn't get rid of that, you see. Yes, they did conquer the third dimension, but they didn't conquer fifth dimension at all. So what's happened is, why reason why May was so critical is because the fifth dimensionals on this planet had to keep their own spiritual clarity going through this and not get suicidally depressed when the third dimension attitude of repentance, the third dimensional repentance attitude, was crushed. They could not get despondent about it. So I went through a period at the end of May of being very despondent, but I got through it, and that's why the breakthrough happened on June 1st, where the fifth dimensional awareness is now pouring in upon the planet, pouring its blessing upon the planet. And I'm telling you, June 30th, I was told there's going to be a big, big blessing, a big relief on June 30th. That is what around that time. It could be a little before or a little after. It's scheduled about June 30th. Fifth dimensional blessing, a tremendous blessing, a boost for those who want to repent. And repentance means just drop this silly prepping for time, to step into time. That's all. And so third dimensionally, this planet is cooked, absolutely cooked, no question about it. It's over. But it's not over for the fifth dimensionals at all. And of course, fifth dimensionals are able to dwell any place they want to. They can dwell on another planet, another dimension, another realm. They're not bound by the prepping. Part of the prepping is to feel you're bound to a certain place, like a planet. That's all part of this prepping for time. That somehow you are a physical body, a person, and you are in a particular place, and bound by this place, etc., etc., etc. It's nonsense. Total nonsense. That's just part of the prepping. That's part of the simulation of spirit stepping the time. Spirit is everywhere. Is everywhere and nowhere simultaneously. Reality is everywhere and nowhere simultaneously. It's residing everywhere and nowhere, residing within everywhere and nowhere, always. And there's no such thing as being stuck. So the fifth dimensional perspective, the perspective of repentance, is not stuck. It is not stuck. It's not stuck here. It's not stuck anywhere. And what I've seen coming is this realization that we're not stuck here. We're not stuck in this fourth dimensional prepping nightmare. We're not stuck. Whereas, of course, 3D feels very stuck. So the problem with 3D is that 3D has realized that they've been enslaved, and they feel that they're stuck. And of course, that's going to be a very nasty situation. No question about it. The subjugation will become, you know, physical. It will become very severe. You know, it's basically a mopping up exercise by the fourth dimensionals. They will certainly do a mopping up here and elimination of any, you know, any notion of 3D repentance. The problem is that 3D repentance was a beginning. It was a beginning. A beginning was made. An effort was made. But it was not brought to fruition or completeness at all. There's still quite a bit of third dimensional repentance is rudimentary. It's vague and still ambivalent. And the fact that it's so ambivalent was what allowed 3D to be overrun by 4D pride, because 3D was easily distracted by 4D fun, saying, wow, wait a minute, maybe all this hard work of repentance, I don't really need that, I can have all this fun. Fun in every sort of direction, just complete excess and you know, hedonistic, you can live a, you know, extremely hedonistic lifestyle, and everything will be cured with drugs and no consequences to any actions, and you just feel like, so 3D said, whoa, wait a minute, you know. So their repentance was, 3D repentance was, again, incomplete, rudimentary, easily their heads were turned. Many were turned, not all. The challenge was to leap from 3D repentance to 5D repentance. That was the challenge of these times. And so we've been working like crazy to meet this challenge. And we'll see by June 30th if we've succeeded in that. And of course, 3D has been conned, because 4D is really not some hedonistic paradise. It's actually a control freak nightmare, dystopian nightmare, actually. You will not, all that stuff was just marketing, okay? All this idea of, you know, the swinging 60s and all this stuff, it's all marketing. It was all marketing. It's thinking like, wow, I just live in this hedonistic paradise. No, not at all. Yeah, 4D is very intense in its obsessions with complexity and control. And everyone gets caught up in this complexity and control, and it's just it is no fun at all. You might even say that 3D is much more enjoyable than 4D, actually, in a lot of ways. Because 4D is a feeling like you've almost got it. If you just obsess about it a little more, just a little more obsessive complexity and control, you will complete your preparations for time, to step into time. So it's there's that greater obsession, complexity, and pride. And that's actually no fun at all. Very arrogant too. The attitude of like, we are just about ready to step into time and we've almost got it. There's an arrogance to it. So 3D was, of course, sold the bill of goods, absolutely. But I think one has to be forgiving of oneself over that. forgive. You know, this incredible mass marketing campaign that 4D undertook on this planet. Of course we were going to be, have our heads turned a little bit, absolutely. There's no reason to feel, you know, condemn oneself for that at all. Absolutely not. I think just virtually everyone on this planet had their heads turned to some extent. Like, wait, you know, who's that new girl walking down the block? You know, it's kind of like, wow. The music, see the wind. Yeah. Who's that new girl walking down the block? What? You know, what is that? You know, it's like, huh? So the world had their heads turned by 4D, of course. So that's just par for the course. You know, you made a nice par, and that's fine. The whole deal was to bounce back from that. So that's what I'm about, is bouncing back from that. I definitely had my head turned to some extent. And then you realize, uh-oh, I had my head turned. I better pull my head back away from that new girl walking down the block and focus, you know, on repentance. So you have to, like, pull your attention away from 4D, as it were. I had my head turned, but actually what I did was I intentionally got into it to overcome the attraction to it. It's like you talk to the new girl walking down the block, hey, how you doing, blah, 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 blah. You flirt with her and then you figure out what she's really about, and then you say, ah, forget it. That's no good. So I basically intentionally flirted with 4D, did all this stuff, this really cool stuff, as it were, in many ways. And then I said, no, you know, that's not it. So I call it fire breaking, in which in order to prevent, you know, a huge, terrible, destructive wildfire, you set a little wildfire in a controlled way and you burn an area out. That's a fire break now. All this area's already been burned out. So when the big fire tries to get to the rest of the fuel, it can't jump over that fire break. That's how you fight fires. You set backfires, as it were, to prevent it from spreading. So I did definitely flirt with 4D. I had all the stuff about 4D. I seemed to be into it. But I was into it in order to overcome the attraction to it, so then it could be dropped at the right time. And it worked. So then I could then bring through the 5D clarifications of repentance and really understand what repentance is really about and get it clear. When you see what it's really about, then 4D doesn't really seem very attractive at all. It's, you know, it's over for 4D. As far as attractiveness goes, you just say, forget it. So it was a tremendous effort, actually, to work through the attraction of 4D and then bring in the fifth dimensional clarity. All of that was just a complete, full-on effort, total effort. Very intense, so intense it's just been unbelievable, the intensity of it all. But the payoff is coming. The payoff is coming, which is we get to now, instead of simulating stepping into time, what is the fifth dimension? Okay, instead of simulating stepping into time, we simulate stepping into reality. See, that's it. Instead of prepping to step into time, we prep to step into eternity. That's a whole different kind of prepping. So we don't drop our prepping. We change what the prep is for. Okay, so there's a continuity, smoothness of continuity there. We're not going to just drop. We're so time. It would seem very odd for Spirit to drop prepping altogether. So what we do, Spirit does now, is it preps to step into eternity. No time, see? Timelessness. It preps to step into timelessness. And so fifth dimension is this prepping to step into timelessness. That's what the fifth dimension is all about. So the fifth dimension is not the ultimate. It's still a prepping. It's still a prepping. Ultimately, the ultimate is to drop all prepping entirely and to realize that we've never left what we are. Experiencing totality, experiencing the totality has always been taking place. And there's no reason for any prep at all. That's the ultimate. But we're not concerned about that step at this point. We're more focused on choosing the fifth dimensional situation, which is a prepping to step into the totality, into timelessness. It's a prepping to let go of prepping, as it were. But we'll say it's a prepping to step into timelessness, which isn't really a step at all. But so that is what we have to look forward to, which is a great thing. And the reason why I bring up relocation is because that at this point, that is how I see it. This planet here is under control of the fourth dimensional pride. Absolutely it is. There's no question about that. And they have the upper hand, and now they have the upper hand, they're going to use it. They're going to become what's called heavy-handed. You can feel the heavy-handedness now. You can feel it. It's being used constantly, everywhere now in the world. The heavy-handedness is just pounding third-dimensional, the attitude of repentance in this world, just pounding it into the ground. So, I would assume that there's going to be a relocation into the fifth dimension, a fifth dimensional dwelling place. That those who have decided to prep to step into timelessness, they will actually be relocated to a dwelling place for them, for themselves. And it is pointed out in the Bible, for instance, that this is going to happen, and that the bodies, the physical bodies we have, will be transformed into bodies of light, as it were, to dwell in this fifth dimensional dwelling place. So that may very well happen. But I'm not overly focused on that. Whatever happens, happens. What's important, though, is to understand the purpose of it all. That's more important than the details of how it happens. That's not nearly as important as the purpose of it. It's a prepping to step into timelessness. Now, can we step into timelessness right now? Of course we can. Or can we prep for that? Yes, we can. Most of the teachers on this planet now, the non-dual teachers, etc., they're prepping to step into timelessness. There's no question they are prepping for that. Have they stepped into it yet? No, not really. No, or have they dropped all prep? No, they have not. They're still prepping for it, and they've got glimpses of it, and they can see the purpose of their prep, and they're talking about it. Yes. But have they actually stepped into it? No. When you actually step into it, and when you drop prep altogether, there's a different quality of present. There's nothing wrong with all these non-dual Advaitin teachers. No, they're useful in that they are talking about. And so they say, hey, let's prep for timelessness. Absolutely. My concern is how viable is that? Will that continue to be on this planet? Really? That is a question, because fourth dimensionality is not interested in that at all, and third dimensionality doesn't really understand it. they keep thinking that, you know, it's a rudimentary. They're trying to mix both repentance and non-repentance together. So they want to have both. They want to have both. And they're trying to figure out a magical way that makes sense. So, we will see what happens. We will see what happens. Whatever is going to happen should happen pretty soon now. There's a difference. You take the, like, the average Advaitin non-dual teacher that is, you know, doing the who am I, where's the I, where's the self. That's all prepping to step into timelessness. Absolutely it is. But you compare them to like Ananda Mahima or Van Maharshi. Compare them, for instance, Ananda Mahima was abiding in, it was the totality abiding within the totality. There was no prep ever. And she said she never undertook any prep whatever. Never had happened. So that was, there's a different feeling to that. It's just like, whoa. Yeah, those who went to see that came away just saying, oh my gosh, you know, well, that is just a whole different, you know, intensity altogether. That is very true. So that would be simply no prep at all, dropping prep entirely, where there's no prep taking place at all. That is the ultimate goal. So there were few that showed the ultimate goal to the world. And then what we're doing is we're prepping for the fifth dimension to step into timelessness. We're prepping for that. But even the step into timelessness, after that, there is still then the relinquishing of all prep altogether. And so there's still a final step that takes place, but we're not concerned with the final step. We're concerned about prepping for timelessness, stepping into timelessness, as it were. And it can be done here. It can be done. I'm not seeing it, the full flowering of it so much. I mean, there are definitely teachers who have dropped, who are prepping for it, and have got a sense of timelessness, etc. There are, the full flowering is not, doesn't really take place here so much, but that's okay. But what I see is this fourth dimensional subjugation of the planet is what that will do to all these, this, you know, prep here, fifth dimensional prep, is a big question, actually. And it may be that the whole thing has to be lifted up into the fifth dimension. I would certainly assume that has to take place. Because the command and control situation of this planet now, and the bureaucracy, and the new world religion that is going to take place, is really going to redefine what these non-dual teachers are doing. And that's already been taking place. So they seem to feel like they're kind of, they don't have the it factor, you know. It just doesn't feel that they have the verbiage, they have all this stuff, but it just seems kind of tepid, like lukewarm, the lukewarmness, so to speak. This is the result of the fourth dimensional. They're redefining the whole thing to put the brakes on it, as it were. And so it becomes academic, it becomes stale, it becomes academic, and it doesn't really resonate the way it's supposed to. And that's what I, over the years, that's what I've seen, is this non-dual Advaitin teaching, new Advaitin teaching, it's actually lost steam. It's lost its intensity. It's lost that the resonating factor. It's gotten, the bell has gotten fainter and fainter and fainter and fainter. It's still ringing, still can hear it, but it's fainter and fainter and fainter and fainter here. That's what I've seen. So that's the result of the fourth dimensionality coming in here. and the pride of that, saying, hey, we don't really need that. Say, oh yeah, that's cool, but we have something better. And that will grab, that's been eroding it, you know, it's been eroding it. And it's people's heads are still, are turning more and more to the fourth dimension. And so it's just the vibrancy of that has been lost. It just doesn't feel vibrant anymore. There was a strong vibrancy due to Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima in the world. And also a few others that were also very strong. And that produced this tremendous vibrancy of, hey, yes, we can. We can do this. We can truly repent. We can truly switch our prepping from prepping for time to prepping to timelessness. There was enormous vibrancy of that feeling as resonating so strong. And over the last 30, 35 years or so, or let's say 40 years, that has, the vibrancy has faded and faded and faded and faded, like a very faded pair of jeans, you know. It's just, and now that faded, those faded jeans are now hip and chic and cool. So what you get is this notion that this sort of lukewarm getting it is, that's what's cool. That's how the fourth dimension works. They're very tricky, very tricky. So now these real tattered old faded pair of jeans, that's now fashionable. So what happened, what will happen, what's happening is that this kind of lukewarm pseudo repentance becomes super fashionable. People say, oh yeah, you know, a little hit of that, that's great. And yet we can do that, and then all this fourth dimensional stuff too, you see. It becomes enfolded into the fourth dimensional culture. And the purpose is lost sight of. And that's what's been happening. However, the vibrancy of those times of mid-century, last century, that was because of these heavyweights, mostly in India, some Tibetan influence there, some Buddhist influence, some Christian influence. There was all this heavyweight influence taking place of all, from all traditions, a Sufi influence, etc., etc. There was this vibrancy, and what happened was that was enough to carry some across this terrible troubles of the invasion of the fourth dimensionals on this planet, so that we can get to this point of June 2013 where now we can focus on this relief that's now going to come. So we were not subjugated, in other words. Some of the slaves got free. They're able to. So without that situation, cat's getting a little restless, but it's going to settle down. Without that vibrancy of the mid-century, from these great boot helpers that came into this world, just radiating the totality reality to us, being to us, we would not have gotten through it. No question, we would not have gotten through it. And to mention one other aspect, which was super important, was A Course in Miracles by Jesus, who, without that, I wouldn't have gotten through it. No way. No way, no how. So it was a combination of all the great traditions on this planet, providing a boost to us, a great boost, that enabled some of us to still be vibrantly focused on the goal here. Even though I'm exhausted, there's still some vibrancy here, you know. Physically, my nervous system, physically, everything, I'm just like, you know, like collapsing at the finish line, as it were. But I still feel that this, you know, vibrancy of the message is still here. I'm very encouraged and enthusiastic about it. Very optimistic right now. So of course, the Holy Spirit knew that the fourth dimensionals would invade this planet. That's been known for thousands of years, or forever, but it's been very well known, and we've been warned. And just prior to this, the severity of the invasion taking place, the blitzkrieg, just prior to the blitzkrieg, there these great aspects of God's grace came into the world. Nanda Mahima, Ramana Maharshi, A Course in Miracles, and others from other traditions, etc. They came into the world, and we got this enormous boost of repentance. Enormous boost. It became clarified for us, very clear. In other words, like Ananda Maima personified the goal, showcased the goal, saying, this is, you can do it, this is what you are going to experience. And Ramana Maharshi, the same thing, saying, abide in, I am the self, abiding in the self, showing us that abidance is the answer. And then Jesus coming along with the Course in Miracles and explaining, giving the explanation through concepts and words, a crystal, very amazing explanation, which enabled us to push aside the sophisticated explanations of the fourth dimensionals, bringing of all the psychology and psychology, all this stuff. We're able to get past all of that. That's what enabled this vibrancy to still be here. Now, there may be plenty of those in the world who are still sluggish, and they're just like, their heads are still turned to 4D, and they're feeling sluggish. So they're not able to quite, their sails are not up, they're not able to catch the wind of this vibrancy in their sails. However, they're still afloat. The boat is still afloat. So at some point, maybe they can run the sail up the mast and have their sails filled with this breeze of vibrancy, of fifth dimensional vibrancy. Fifth dimensional is not subjugated by fourth dimension at all. There's no subjugation at all. So if they're free, fifth dimension is free. They're blissful. I mean, fifth dimension is blissful. It is full of repentance and the prepping to step into timelessness. Absolutely. So that breeze can still fill your sails if you just run your sail up the mainmast and don't be so downcast. No reason to be downcast. And many, many people are realizing that new girl of 4D is not so pretty at all. She's a wicked witch, as it were. No question about it. And they're saying, uh-oh, wow. You know, what do we do? This is terrible. This is terrible. We thought it was all kind of cool, but now we realize it's not cool at all. And you know, they lowered their sails, and now they say, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? Put your sails back up. Put your hopes back up. Put your expectations back up. That the fifth dimensional vibrancy has not been subjugated. And that breeze can come. I feel that breeze will come into the world soon, within a month, within some time frame, towards the end of June. I feel there's going to be that the breeze of fifth dimensional vibrancy, the vibrancy of repentance, will be felt, begin to be felt here. See, we needed a time to at least consider fourth dimensionality. Our heads were turned. We needed to go through that and have our heads turned and say, wow. And now we realize we can say, ah, you know, just how terrible, how trashy it really is, how pathetic it really is. Fourth dimensionals are pathetic, really pathetic. And, you know, as are third dimensionals. But we had already understood that, right? I mean, the whole point of the third dimensional is to realize how pathetic the third dimensional is. Okay, that is pathetic, but we accepted it. The problem was we hadn't yet seen how pathetic the fourth dimensionals are. And now that we've seen that, you know, living in Silicon Valley is a great place to see how pathetic they really are. Truly. Just what can you say except they're very pathetic. having seen that now, we're willing to set sail to the fifth dimension. But we weren't really willing to do that until another, see, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many still wandering around, out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. One more day to get my loved ones in. And so we're saying, hey, wait a little longer, Jesus. Don't come yet. That's been the mantra. It really has. People say, well, where's Jesus? How come he hasn't come back? Because they're saying, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. Wait a little longer, please. And of course, Jesus just means the attitude of repentance. We just personified the attitude of repentance as, quote unquote, this person called Jesus. But it's really an attitude. It's an orientation. It's a prepping to step into timelessness. That's what it really, that's what Christ really is. Christ is the attitude of true repentance. So that attitude of true repentance is about to return to this planet and send the breeze of that attitude through the planet to lift us up to into the fifth dimension. Now, will there be an actual person called Jesus? I don't know. But there isn't any, you know, personifying it is okay. That's more third dimensional type of thing. It doesn't need to be personified, but if it is, that's fine too. I don't care either way. It doesn't really make that much difference to me. But the breeze is an attitude. It's an orientation. It's the breeze of repentance. Of instead of prepping to step into time, prepping to step into timelessness. Because, of course, there never will be any time. Time will never exist at all. That is a fact. So, in terms of, like, for instance, for me to go to, like, a non-dual teacher or something, I was watching on YouTube, what I see is there's a lack of vibrancy. What I'm trying to convey here is a sense of vibrancy. Maybe that's why I put the red shirt on today. Very vibrant. Because we need to shake off the sluggishness and the attitude of defeat. We need to shake it off. We need the bell to be ringing now. Boom, you know, really ringing. And the non-dual teachers, they're kind of just like, it seems like they're just going through the motions. Okay, and they're explaining it calmly, and yes, but there's a certain resignation there, some kind of feeling like resignation and sloth and lack of vibrancy to it. The feeling of like, there's no defeat at all. We are completely undefeated. We are ready to advance into the fifth dimension, and it's going to happen real soon. And we're not stuck here. We're not stuck in this world at all. So I don't want to get into that attitude of sort of stale resignation, as it were, just a lack of vibrancy. I want to push the vibrancy. Because something wonderful is coming, actually. A tremendous victory is coming, actually. A tremendous victory is coming. What the fourth dimensionals were trying to do was prevent us from preparing for this great victory. So we didn't expect it. So since we didn't prepare for it, didn't expect it, we would reject it. Okay, they failed in that. They failed. Because I certainly still expect it. And a tremendous victory is on its way very soon. A tremendous victory. Tremendous victory. A victory over the fourth dimension. A victory meaning that we're going to turn towards repentance in its fullness. We're going to prep for full repentance. We're going to prep for full repentance. That's the great victory. That is the great, great destiny that we have right now. We have a great destiny. Truly wonderful destiny. Because the prepping for repentance is wonderful. We'll have access to the great teachers, the great repenters, are those who have simply never, ever prepped at all. For instance, Anandamayimon never prepped at all for time, never. Have access to that. Have access to Jesus. Have access to those who have completely repented and even dropped the whole notion of prepping at all. And it is said that sitting in the presence of those is indescribable, is absolutely indescribable. I just had a comment on the video for the advice of Anandamayimon of someone apparently who sat in a presence. And he said, words cannot describe it. You simply cannot describe it. The uplift there, the true uplift there, is just indescribable. Indescribably wonderful, as it were. So we have this now. Our future destiny is to prep for stepping into timelessness. And that means that feeling, ultimately the feeling of no need for any prep at all. No need for any prep at all, actually. Eventually. And that is just, you know, it is the totality, experiencing the totality. And how rich is that? It is endlessly rich. It is endlessly wonderful. So we have this bliss, this calm, this richness. All these things are directly ahead of us right now. Directly ahead of us right now. And so that is a tremendous victory. Tremendous victory. The fourth dimensionals just hoped that they left everybody despondent at this time. Their goal was to make everybody despondent and really try to get people who had held out hope for deliverance from this to commit suicide. That was their goal. So I know there's some of you who probably towards the end of May felt very despondent. I certainly did. I actually got suicidal for a while. But I just noticed it and I just kind of laughed at it and said, okay, that won't last. I said, just noticed. Okay, fourth dimension, that's just your last hurrah. You're trying to, you know, pull me down. Definitely, there was that, you could feel the tentacles, you know, trying to get a hold of you. And, you know, it did not. So I imagine I still feel relatively despondent in various ways because the whole situation is is very problematical as far as the future goes here in this world. But, as far as getting the clarity through, which is boosting me up now, I was able to do that. June 1st, it all came flooding through. So the fourth dimensional attempt to drive the fifth dimensionals on this planet into despondency, at least in my case, it failed. And one failure is a total failure, actually. One failure is a total failure. And I'm sure it failed in many cases all over, too. It really did fail. So, you will probably find your spirits picking up now. Vibrancy returning. Vibrancy returning. And it's not third dimensional vibrancy of some pretty girl sort of thing. Vibrancy. No. Vibrancy is... It's laughter. There's this spiritual laughter, you know, just a spiritual laughter, and freedom, and knowing, and certainty, the vibrancy of certainty. The vibrancy of certainty is a whole different kind of certainty. It's not just I'm a pretty prepper, you know, kind of thing. That's not it. It's the vibrancy of certainty. That's what we're going towards, is the vibrancy of certainty. So we're leaving aside the goals of 3D, and certainly leaving aside the goals of 4D, and now we're picking up the goal of 5D, the vibrancy of certainty. So we'll see how that plays out. But expect June now to be just a celebration, really. Turn your June into a celebration. It's time to celebrate, because the vibrancy of certainty is on its way to us now. It's on its way. And we have not succumbed. And we will expect it. We will expect it, and we will entertain it, and we will accept it, and we will benefit from it. Because the perspective I've shown has been, we're able to turn the perspective around on 4D. We're able to do it. It's doable. I've done it. So the fact is that I've done it means it's doable. Which, see, that's it for 4D. Silly. And this perspective is like, wow. It's not like we're in time trying to get out of it. You see, that's what the paradigm we've been into. That, how do I escape from time? No. We've never been in it. We've been only simulating the stepping into it, how it would be in time. But it's not ever happened. Time has never happened yet. And it never will happen. This is all important. So, the fact that this perspective shift can take place, it's already taking place here, means it can take place with you too. There's no question about it. No question about it. So 4D, it just shows you that there is something beyond 4D. There's no question about it. Absolutely. There absolutely is. And so knowing that, you just say, come on, all right. We're ready. Let's go. Let's, the vibrancy of certainty. However it's personified, however we feel it, whether it's their persons associated with it or not, the vibrancy of certitude. Is coming. The vibrancy of certitude is coming. And then we say, how do we relate to this vibrancy of certitude? We relate to it by realizing that we're going to prep to step into timelessness. That is how we do it. We don't give up prep, okay? We don't just become, you know, completely spaced out. Now, we can still continue our prep. We can still function just how we're functioning. But we realize, oh, I can now prep to step into timelessness. And there's a way to prep for that. I know it. And the certitude is telling me, yes, you can. Real hope and change is on its way. Right, not the 4D hope and change that happened in 2000, January 20th, 2008. That hope and change was 4D hope and change. Okay, now so we say we're waiting. We're ready for the real hope and change, which is to change what we're prepping for, and that gives us the hope of absolute certitude. So let's get ready. For that, let's get ready for that. So it's a celebration now. Let's start the celebration. June is a celebration. We've made it through the fire. We've made it through the burning ground. We say, well, we, or what are you talking about? We, or whatever. It's been made through. If one makes it through, we all make it through. If one makes it through, we all make it through. Now, we may still feel the residue of despondency, of course. But the fact is that this certitude, the breeze of certitude, the breeze of repentance, the attitude of repentance, the breeze of certitude will be made welcome in this world. I will certainly make it welcome. And that welcome will spread out. It will spread out. And so the world will get this blessing. It will get this ascension. It will get the uplift. What I mean by that, I mean those who want to repent will get that uplift. Of course, the 4Ds and the 3Ds have had their heads turned. They'll be like Led Zeppelin, you know. Zeppelin full of lead. They won't get off the ground, that is for sure. But those who are decided, yeah, I want to prep for the step into timelessness. And if exchange, I always say, choose a new idea, exchange hypothetical scenarios, exchange simulations means exchange your prepping for time for prep for prepping for timelessness. That's all that means. Very simple. Now, I don't know what's going to happen in my case. I may start getting some boost as possible, so that I'm prepared to really welcome this attitude of repentance into the world, as it were. So that's possible. I may start getting some little boost, and yeah, to get ready in celebrate mood of celebration. That is possible. I don't know. If it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But still, let us start being a little more vibrant here. Little celebration. Let's say, yes, we can. And you say, well, it's only one or two or three. It doesn't matter. As long as there is a welcome wagon, so to speak, as long as there's a receptivity to it, whoever has their sails up will start to move. Will start to ascend. And you can see that, and you'll see, oh my gosh, there goes a sailboat. Look at that. They're going to that beautiful place, you know. And then you say, I can put my sail up too. You'll see it. Oh, all that matters is that some sailboats start moving. The sails are up and the sails are full. And they say, where's that breeze coming from? You'll feel it. The breeze will be here. And all you got to do is put your sail up. That's it. So at least you realize the breeze is coming. The breeze. This breeze is the attitude of repentance. It is the breeze of certitude. The breeze of certitude. That time will never be. There's never going to be time. See, we think we're in time. We're just simulating time. We're just simulating it. There is no such thing as time. Never will be. So that is like a great celebration. Wow. You know, wow. So I will ask the Holy Spirit what to do next. And we'll find out what to do next. But this is a tremendous time now for us. Shake off the dust of despondency at this time. We're going to start shaking off the dust of despondency. Shake off the dust of despondency. A great victory has been won. A great victory has been won. All right, we'll see what I can do next with the time, with quote-unquote time, I mean chronological moments. We'll see what we can do with that going forward right now. All right, very great. Let's celebrate.